A gospel lesson is found in the gospel according to Luke. We'll be reading from the first chapter, beginning at verse 46. And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. Surely from now on all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham, and to his descendants forever." The Gospel of our Lord. This particular week, I wrestled with our scripture and our sermon for today. And primarily it's because I found it interesting that the Sunday we light the Advent candle of joy, we are also assigned the scripture lesson which focuses on justice. I say that it's interesting to me because often the church has shied away from conversations about justice. We have done this by separating the human experience into two realms. Often we prefer to speak about the spiritual dimension of the human condition rather than the physical. And yet, we find ourselves most comfortable because of that talking about spiritualizing challenges and hardship. We find it easier to speak about the poor in spirit rather than to focus on the poor in wealth and resources. We're more comfortable articulating the state of those that hunger and thirst for righteousness and experience reluctance in speaking about the condition of those that are hungry and thirsty, period. We can find great comfort in conversations about finding our home for our heart in Jesus, and yet struggle to find the words to speak about finding a home for those without a permanent roof over their heads. Maybe the struggle is that it revolves around having to look at the world in which we are living and the systems that support and perpetuate these realities. Maybe the difficulty is born in having to take note even of the ways we sometimes benefit from unjust and inequitable systems. Nevertheless, the result is the same. A void is created as though God has nothing to say to those who perpetuate these systems of injustice, as though God has nothing to say even to those who are suffering or burdened or feeling alone. And yet, when we read the Bible, when we look at the stories of the Bible, we find that they address over and over again justice as a requirement of God and God's preferred future for all people. So, how does justice and joy relate? The prophet Isaiah lets us know that they relate because God sees those that are living under conditions of inequity and injustice, and God will not be silent. God will not be unmoved. God will not ignore or spiritualize what is wrong. Instead, God acts, God moves, God makes a way, especially when none seem to exist. This is good news of great joy that is worth talking about and sharing wherever we go, because it reminds us that God is at work in our world. God is at work calling and anointing and setting apart and sending out those who will speak words of hope to the burdened and heal the hurting and declare freedom to the captives and comfort those that mourn. The good news is that God knows the troubles we've seen and the sorrows we've borne and has never been indifferent to it. There is joy in knowing that because God is able to change things, even when it sometimes seems beyond our own abilities. One of the things that inspires me about this is that there are times when we find ourselves in situations that are out of our control. There are times when we have no capacity to change our circumstance or ability to impact the wrongs in our lives. Now, I have to admit and be honest that even as I say those words, there's a part of me that wants to push back. There's a part of me that wants to say, that's not true. Maybe you're experiencing that yourself. You see, I was raised with the motto, believe it, conceive it, achieve it. We were preached that as kids growing up, my sister and I. And we were raised to embrace our agency, to believe that we could accomplish anything we set our minds to know that if we just pressed hard enough, if we worked hard enough, if we did more, we would get what we wanted in life. In fact, in our household, my sister and I were not even allowed to say the word can't. The moment that word even kind of uttered from our lips, my parents would be like, It was just not a thing we were allowed to say. And yet, even as I still want to believe that, there are examples in our reality, in our world, in our lives, and in the lives of others that shows us that that is not always the case. I want to share with you three true stories. One is of a friend of mine who, by every measurement, was successful. By every standard, by every measurement, you would look at her life and consider her a success. And then one day she went to work and lost her job. This is about 20, 25 years ago when executives were going and they were downsizing and handing out pink slips like it was candy. She lost her job. And after losing her job, she worked and looked for a job and looked and was going through her savings until there was nothing left. And then she lost her marriage. And then she lost her home. And then she became homeless. And how is that possible? How is that possible for someone who did everything right? And yet here it is years later, and we're seeing the same thing happening to millions of people today because of this pandemic. Where is the control? Where is our ability to affect change in our own lives? The second story. In my former church, young men whom I knew from the time they were children, kept getting stopped and frisked by the police while they were on their way to work or to school or to the church or home or their friend's house or to the store. These experiences often left them demeaned and demoralized, angry and afraid, because they had no means to change it. Nothing they wore, nothing they did, no way they acted would stop it from happening. And sadly, their stories became the norm rather than the exception in some of our communities. Third story. I have a friend who worked for many years doing a praiseworthy job at his firm. We actually both worked on Wall Street together. All of a sudden, after being at this job for several years, he began to be harassed, started to receive poor work performances, was threatened with a demotion and told that he was going to receive a cut in pay. Why, you may ask? Well, because his supervisor found out he was gay. These stories of injustice and inequity, they're not unique. They're not something that just happens to a few people. They are happening to people all over our communities, all over our towns and our cities and our country. And it can seem so much larger than anything we have the capacity to change, especially when we are going through it ourselves. But it is not too big for God. That's the story of Isaiah. It is not too big for God, because in the midst of everything, the Lord sees and hears and knows, and God is at work, even when hope seems futile and possibilities seem impossible. That's what makes Mary, the mother of Jesus, such an amazing woman. She believed and trusted in God's promises in spite of the oppression, in spite of the injustices that she and her people had experienced down through the generations. She believed that God had not forgotten them, but would show mercy to those that knew no mercy and justice to those that had experienced injustice time and time again. In response to all that God has promised, Mary sings a song of joy. She sings rejoicing in God, her Savior. She sings celebrating God who has the power to turn the world upside down to make it right side up for her and those who are hurting. She sings for God has chosen her, and all generation because of it will call her blessed. To hear Mary's song is to hear joy for people who have been delivered from the injustices and the inequities of the world. Amazingly, when her child grows to be a man, the scriptures tell us that he walked into the temple, began to read this passage from the book of Isaiah, and in the presence of everyone gathered, declared that the scripture had been fulfilled through him. Of all the images Jesus could have used to identify with, of all the passages he could have quoted, he chose to begin his ministry as the anointed one, sent by God to preach and teach and model God's mercy and justice and love for all people who had been waiting for a Savior to deliver them. Through Christ, we know God's love as Christ willingly sacrificed his life for us so that we might be forgiven and made right with God. Through Christ, we know God sees and hears and moves as the Holy Spirit draws us close and blesses us with peace and power and strength to persevere through the storms. And because of Christ, we have this amazing calling on our lives, this calling that sets us apart and sends us out into the world as followers of Jesus, who continues his life-giving and love-transforming work of healing and hope, justice and joy, care and compassion, equity and peace in this world that is loved by God, so that God's reign might come and God's will be done on earth as it already is in heaven. My brothers and sisters, let us wait with joy as we work and watch and we say, "Come, Lord Jesus, come." Amen. Let us pray together. Oh, holy God, we thank you. We know no other joy like yours. For even in the midst of hardship and sorrow, even in the midst of challenging times and so much other things, your love, your presence, your grace, your mercy, all of it brings us joy. We know that you are here, that you have not forsaken us, that you are at work in our lives and in the lives of all people. And so we thank you, God, and we bless your name. And we lift you up, for you and you alone are God. We pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus, our Lord and Savior, our brother and our friend. Amen.